Hi, we are going to look at some more spring mass systems and think a little bit more about some more complicated sorts of systems. So in this material, what we're going to look at is called forced motion. So you'll see the differential equation here that we've been using so far, at least the left-hand side of the differential equation looks like what we've been using so far. But instead of zero on the right-hand side of the differential equation here, we have this function capital F of t, and sometimes that's a lowercase f or a capital F or whatever name you want to call it. But the idea here is that F represents some other external force that is applied to the system. So there's a lot of different forms that could take, but you might have a spring mass system that is set in motion and is governed by the left side of the differential equation, but then maybe there's some other part in the machine that you're trying to describe that is also imparting another external force to the spring that you're trying to describe its motion. And so that would be an example of what this capital F of t is. We'll also see that there are circuit problems that can be described by a very similar differential equation. And so in those circuit problems, the function on the right hand side here, the capital F of t, would actually be like an external voltage applied to some kind of circuit. So we call these kinds of systems forced motion because we have this other external force that's applied to the system. Occasionally you'll see this also called driven motion. And so I'm going to kind of zoom out a little bit so you can kind of see the overall picture, and then we'll zoom back in and talk about some specifics. So these are the notes for our class. And so there's a couple pages here. And what I want to emphasize is that we're really going to break this down into kind of two different sorts of situations. If we have a system that has no damping on the spring mass system, so that's an idealized system where C is equal to zero, then we're going to describe what happens in those sorts of situations. And then the other sort of situation is if we do have damping when C is not equal to zero. And it's important to understand that there's never really any ideal system with completely zero friction in the system. But sometimes if C is very, very close to zero, you actually get better models from looking at this system without damping than worrying about a more complicated equation with a very, very, very small value of C. So in practice, systems have damping in them. Internal friction is one way in which there might be damping, but there are others. But we're going to talk about these systems without damping because sometimes those equations can still give good models for what's happening in the system, even though there might be some friction, it's a very small amount of damping applied to the system. Okay, so we're going to focus on if we have no damping, C is equal to zero first. All right, so the differential equation will be of this form. So no C term there since C is zero. And so if you think about solving that characteristic polynomial for the YH part of the solution, you're going to get two pure imaginary zeros of that characteristic polynomial. So you get YH is just the sum of scalar multiples of some trig functions. Okay, so that gives the YH part of the solution. And then the YP part of the solution is going to depend on what that function F of t is like. And so in these two pictures here, we're going to focus on that F of t being periodic function, a periodic function. So maybe there's some kind of other rotating part or something like that. We will need to learn some more in the next chapter in order to handle more complicated kinds of forcing functions. So for now, we're going to focus on this where the forcing function is periodic. All right, so when we have that kind of situation, we basically have two sorts of solutions that we get. And again, this is when we have no damping or such a small value of C of damping that we can model it with no damping. And then this forcing function that is also periodic. And so the issue is that you've got a periodic motion that's going to occur as part of your YH solution. And then you also, if you just kind of think through the differential equation's mechanics of solving a differential equation where that forcing function is also a trig function, you would perhaps use the method of undetermined coefficients, make an appropriate guess, substitute in, find that yp, but your yp is also going to involve trig functions. And so the issue really is whether those two trig functions, the trig functions that are the natural part of the oscillations of the system, and then the trig functions that are part of the forcing function, whether those two functions are in phase with each other or out of phase with each other. So if those two functions are in sync with each other, then you get what's in this first picture here, which is called resonance. So this occurs when the forcing function, f of t, capital F of t, has the same frequency or same period, the same value that is going to control how fast that oscillates as the natural solution from the system. So the key idea there is that you're going to have the forcing function feeding into what's already happening with the system, and you get these larger and larger and larger oscillations, and so these oscillations eventually are going to be, mathematically anyway, the equations are going to describe those oscillations with the amplitude approaching infinity. Practically speaking, your system is probably going to break before the oscillations get that bad. But generally, when you're talking about designing things, you want to design away from resonance because this causes whatever system you're working with to break. All right, so one situation would be if that forcing function is in sync, in phase, same frequency. That frequency would be determined mathematically from the equations from this number that is times the t inside the trig functions. And so if that's the same for the forcing function and the YH part of the solution, it feeds into each other, and so you end up with this resonance. The other possible situation is if they are different. So this occurs when the omega naught, which is what we've used here to describe what's the frequency in the homogeneous part of the solution, is not equal to the omega from the forcing function. So when they're out of phase with each other. So you get various sorts of pictures that look sort of like what I have down here below, called beats. And I graphed something here that really exhibits strong beats, so they're very easy to see. But you can have beats also in a picture where it's maybe not quite so obvious what's happening here. But I want to just talk a little bit about what's happening in this picture. All right, so I've got the period of the forcing function different than the natural period of the system. And so in this picture here, the omega and the omega naught are close to each other, but not equal to each other. And so that's when you see really, really obvious beats. If they're kind of not very close numbers to each other, it's harder sometimes to see these beats. But in these beats, you'll see that the amplitude of the oscillations gets bigger for a while. That is when the forcing function and the natural frequency of the system are working somewhat together. They're a little bit out of phase, but both kind of working in the same direction. And then at some point, if they're out of phase with each other, they will get out of sync with each other and start acting in opposition to each other. And so the amplitude on those oscillations will decrease. So that little dashed line that I drew right there, and if I maybe even continue it here, is what's called an envelope curve. And it's basically just enclosing the actual curve that we have here. So in this sort of picture, I've got two things labeled here on the graph with some numerical formulas. This lower number right here, and there's a little arrow that describes that. So that gives that distance, that would be the t values, between the fast oscillations. So this gives the period of the fast, or sometimes they're called the rapid oscillations. And then higher on the graph, I've got this other formula here, and that describes this distance. And so really that's two b beats, but it's that period of that long envelope curve that I drew there. So if you kind of think about that envelope curve as a trig function itself, that would be the period of that. So this is the period of the beats. I will write here the envelope curve for the beats. Okay, so those are the two kind of pictures that you have when you've got no damping. So let's go ahead and look at one example that has that sort of situation. All right, so we have a description here of a spring mass system, and it tells us that we have no damping, so that's going to indicate our C is equal to zero, and we've got an external forcing function, so this is forced motion, and we want to find the function that describes the resulting motion. So I'm going to start here by writing down the differential equation. So the left hand side is going to be the same as before. We're going to have m times y double prime plus c, that's zero, times y prime plus k times y. So that's the same as our spring mass model from before. But now we're going to have that equal to 9/4 sine of 2.5t. All right, so we have a second order linear non-homogeneous differential equation. I also have some initial values here. So the system is set in motion from its equilibrium position. So that tells me that my initial position is zero. And I have an initial downward velocity of 1/2 meter per second. Remember that we chose to use down as the positive direction here. So we'll have y prime of zero equals positive 1/2. So those are our initial values. All right, so let's think a little bit about solving this differential equation and then think a little bit about what that resulting motion is going to look like. So if you were going to solve this differential equation just outside of the context of a spring mass system, you would find the yh, you would write down the characteristic polynomial, and at this point probably that's pretty straightforward for you. You would write that down, you'd find your r values, and you're going to get plus or minus 2i for those r values. So your yh part of the solution is going to be c1 cosine 2t plus c2 sine 2t. So that 2 describes what's happening with the natural frequency of the spring mass system as it's described without that external forcing function. The forcing function has a frequency that is controlled by this 2.5 that's here. And so one important thing to note here is that that 2.5 and this 2, the 2 is the omega naught, and the 2.5 is the omega, and those things are not equal to each other. So the forcing function is not exactly in phase with the natural frequency of the system. So that's when we're going to get beats, where the oscillations will get bigger for a little while, and then they will get smaller again. All right, I'm going to go ahead and finish solving this differential equation really quickly, and I'm just going to write that work out really quickly. I'm going to go ahead and make a guess for my yp, and then I'm going to substitute that into the differential equation and find my a and my b, and then we'll find our c1 and c2 at the end. Okay, here I've gone ahead and graphed our solution that we got in Desmos, and this is just the default window for Desmos, so I see negative t values, which don't really make sense in the context of this problem. And I'm expecting on this problem to see beats, so I'm going to change the window a little bit here until we can actually see those. So in this window I can see the rapid oscillations, and then I can really see two beats. All right, try some of these homeworks.